And I've been held by the Savior. And I feel fire from above. And I've been down to the river. I ain't the same, the prodigal return. And all my hope is in Jesus. Thank God that yesterday's gone. Yes, all my sins are forgiven. Yeah. I've been washed by the blood, and I'm no stranger to prison, and I've worn shackles and chains. But I've been freed and forgiven. I'm not going back, I'll never be the same. That's why I say, oh, my hope is in Jesus. Thank God that yesterday's gone. Yes, all my sins are forgiven. And yeah, 'cause I've been washed by the blood. And there's a kind of thing that just breaks a man, break him down to his knees. God, I've been broken more than a time or two. And then he picked me up and showed me what it means to be a man. Come on and sing. Oh, my hope is in Jesus. And thank God that yesterday's gone. Yes, all my sins are forgiven. Yeah. Oh, I've been washed by the blood. Oh, I've been washed by the blood.
With the announcements, we're going to talk about men's breakfast. Men's breakfast is at River of Life Church on the 13th at 8 a.m. Men, if you hunger to be, well, if you hunger, if you're hungry, this is a good place to go. But also, if you hunger to be with other men, to discuss God and worship and, you know, even some struggles, this is the place for you. It's most of the denominations here locally, and Kenny will be at this one. So just letting you know, men's breakfast is coming up. Also, women, we have a conference that's coming up in Cannon Beach called Rise Up. Very excited for this one, March 22nd through 24th. They're promoting it as fun, fellowship, beach time, worship, rest, and an inspiring speaker. So I'm excited for the fun, fellowship, and rest aspect. If you want more information, I will be signing up for this today. If anyone would like more information, there is some at the front, or you can talk to me. At this point, I'm thinking I'm going to get my own room, but if somebody wants to share a room, you can contact me. I'm just not going to stay at the Motel 6. At 50, it's just not happening anymore. I'm going to stay at one of the nicer rooms. So if anybody needs any more information about this, like I said, talk to me, or there's more stuff up at the front counter or the main counter.
Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
Anyone have any New Year's resolutions they've made? Challenges? Anyone? No one? I made one. I was going to told my kids every day I'm going to go for a jog in the morning. And it is today's the 7th. I have yet to do it. Every day I walk out, I'm going to go jogging, and then I go sit on the couch. It's kind of a running joke.
You're off to a good start.
Thanks. Oh. I have a friend. Do we have any songwriters that are in our church? Honestly, this is not a joke. Songwriter, we have Kent. Anyone else? Do we have Jerry? Yes, you are. Anyone else? I was just curious if, as I'm fishing here, am I getting anyone new? Really? Interesting. That's good to know. All right. I have a friend who is a songwriter, and he used to want to know, Kenny, what are you preaching on in the next month, the next 2 months? And rarely did I know, but every once in a while, I'd kind of have an idea. But I remember I was going through a series on preaching about Moses, and he wrote a song about God, Yahweh. And we had fun writing, and we started to learn how to play off each other a little bit. And it was so interesting. And I would ask him, kind of, how do you do this songwriting? Because to me, that is such a foreign thing. And he says, when he would play, because he would play guitar and piano and multiple instruments, he says, when I'm playing or when I'm singing or when I'm composing the songs, he's like, usually they come from a really deep place that's inside of me. He said, usually they're a very vulnerable place, and they might come from a childhood memory or a relationship that caused a lot of pain. Sometimes he says, when I look around at the world around me and I see the injustices that are happening, sometimes that really fires me up to write a song. And he says, but the majority of the songs that he writes, and I've heard this from other people, the majority are actually love songs where they're having these emotions or these thoughts and feelings that fill them so much that he's like, it just kind of explodes out. And if we were to listen to songs on the radio, so many of the songs, they do revolve around love, where they catch us up and it's in their heart and explodes out into the keys or onto the strings that they're playing with and they're writing it, and it's coming through their voice as it's, whether sometimes cracking or just this powerful emotion. When it really gets played from a deep place, man, it just catches me up, and I'm singing, and it's coming from my own heart. Our God is a God who, he is this amazing artist in so many different ways, and he's a singer, God is a songwriter and a musician, and he never stops composing and making music, and the place that he writes from is from a very deep place too. It's a very vulnerable place that's inside of him. And I think God has wired us by nature to be curious people. When I was a kid, I remember I was about 13 years old. I took this radio apart because I wanted to understand how that worked. Did anyone else just destroy anything when they're growing up? Just how does it work? Even though I really didn't learn anything about it. I just had then a lot of pieces, and there was no way I was ever going to get that put back together, but I would at least try. But I think it's how God has wired us to be curious. Some people, they want to understand maybe how different diseases work, or Maybe they want to explore and go outer space, and how do these things work? Or people want to ask and find answers to the question of why. Why is the universe so big? How does it keep expanding? How does the human body work? Why are bees attracted to flowers? And what vitamins are going to really affect best my immune system? Or how do I fix this cholesterol problem that I have? Or what causes climate change? Or why are celebrities so fascinating to watch? And the truth is, we'll never probably understand a lot of the questions that maybe we have. And some people, they really struggle to understand math and science. And there are just some things that I can't wrap my brain around, no matter how much I try to understand them and I've tried to study them. It just doesn't always work. I think that if I could, trying to understand math makes my head explode. I just don't have that aptitude for that like my kids do. And some people really struggle at understanding finances and, you know, how does the stock market work? And tell me more about interest rates, because that's doesn't really compute with me. And some people never understand why the Mariners, no matter how good they can be through the series and through the season, they will always crash at the end. Why does that happen? I don't understand. It doesn't really ever seem to make sense. And what could be I think I'm going to be vulnerable here and honest. I don't really understand how cars work. I know men are supposed to. I feel like as a man, I'm supposed to be very like a grease monkey, but I'm not. I'm very envious of people who can kind of change their oil. They just get it. They're like, it's so simple, Kenny. And I'm like, start over. There are just things I don't get. I don't fully understand. And in all of history, one thing that people have never fully understood is understood God, because God is so far beyond our ability to fully comprehend and understand. We can take God and understand Him, I think, in small doses, but we can never fully understand how God created everything. And I can get bits and pieces where I go, yes, I get that God loves me. I can get that sometimes. But I don't even fully always understand that. And I even really work at wrapping my brain around that one. And I get that God gives me peace and He gives me patience. And I know what God has done and how He's healed me. And I know how He has transformed me, and He's still working in me and empowering me. But all those are really just small pieces to a very large puzzle. It's a gigantic puzzle that I don't really understand. And every once in a while, God gives me another small piece, and I can set that down, and I'm like, yeah, all right, I'm making progress. But when I look at that one small piece, every single one of those little pieces, I go, man, that just blows me away. God, You are so great. How do You just keep getting bigger and more awesome? Why are You so great? I'm so grateful that You do love me. Isaiah 55:9, the Lord says, "For just as the heavens are higher than the earth, so My ways are higher than your ways, and My thoughts higher than your thoughts." Bill Murray in the movie, What About Bob, he was talking about his therapist. He says, we can't expect to understand Him. He's so far above us. We're like the ropes on a Goodyear blimp. And that one is deep theology. Hold on to that. Just let it sink in. And it's not because God is so distant or that God is so angry. And it's not even that we're not intelligent. It's not that. It's literally because God is God and we are not God. God is infinite and we are finite. God is perfect and we are imperfect. And God is eternal. And we are bound by the constraints of time, and it's just the nature of who He is and the nature of who we are. And if I could fully understand God, I don't know that I would want to submit my life to God. I don't know that I would do that. And it's part of it, the fact that God is God, and He's so far beyond my own understanding and comprehension. Part of that is evidence for me that I need God, and that I need something that is beyond myself. And while we can never fully understand God, I think we can still know God. I think we can know God intimately and deeply. And there's a huge difference there, because God's greatest desire is to know us and for us to know Him, to know who He is and to be intimate with Him and to have a relationship that He has with me and me to have a relationship with Him and for us to do that. And that's part of the adventure of life, and all of eternity is us discovering those small little puzzle pieces, one after the other, and to continue to grow, to understand Him, and for every single one of them to kind of just blow us away. And that never ends. Every day, discovering more and more about God, because there's no end to God. And I just think that is so cool. So for the next couple weeks, we're going to look at a few things that maybe we don't fully understand, where we say, God, You're amazing, and I think You're so great. Even if I don't fully get You, there is a mystery to You, but I think it's a beautiful mystery. And I think it's exciting that we can continue to investigate God, even if we can never fully understand God. And as we do, we will continue to get to know God personally and how He connects to us as an artist. God is a composer, and He is the God of song. But is all music good music? Hold on.
I fell into a burning ring of fire. I went down, down, down.
Turn to the Mac. Get up, what it is, what it does, what it is, what it isn't. Looking for a better way to get up out of bed.
Oh. See, the floral duet gets me, though. See, we could have put a lot of music on this little playlist of mine. Is all music good music? And the thing is we all have different opinions about what would be good music. And some of us, we would have a broad taste, and we'd say a variety of styles and genres, but in some sense, I think every single one of us would admit that we do love music. I remember the very first time I got my own little Walkman, and I remember the music that was playing, and I'm a child of the 80s, and so I remember vividly learning and hearing these different songs, and I just fell in love with this rock music. And I remember sitting down in high school, and I would try and write out the songs and the lyrics because I thought they're so profound, and I'm trying to figure them out, and I wanted to memorize them because they somehow were a reflection of my soul, and there was like these songs are coming out of my bones. And I remember the very first concert I ever went to vividly. I've been to many concerts since, but none of them have captured me like that one when I was 13 years old. It left a mark on me. And there are some songs that when you hear them, they kind of just pump you up.
We will rock you.
I mean, they're just songs that grab your heart. And then there's songs that, I mean, they just really,
Everything I do,
they make me just,
I do it for you.
And then there are some songs that no matter what you think, no matter what you want, you may not even care. You can't help yourself, but you just start to move. I mean, you might be at standing off to the side at a wedding, and then this song comes on, and you're like, all right, I got to get to the dance floor. You're just starting to... And then everyone, they've got breakup songs. See, Phil Collins for me, he's my breakup song guy. Again, I'm a child of the 80s. And I would crank this song up to 10, and I would be listening to it on repeat over and over. And I had the tape player, so when I say repeat, it's stop, rewind, rewind. Dang, I went too far. Fast forward, fast forward, back just a little bit. Oh, pull it out, make sure it's not, And then we have songs that inspire us. And they get you going. It's like, I need it when I'm jogging and I got to go up a staircase. And then there are songs that they get stuck in your head no matter how many other songs you may listen to after it. That's the song that's going to be coming back into your head. And you're like, ugh! And I love it. And it's stuck in my head. And then there are songs that, like for me, when I was 20 years old, I moved to London and I studied over there. And I saw for the first time theater, like real theater. And they were musicals. And I went to this one production of Les Miserables, and I was in the furthest, tallest balcony at the back row. I mean, I was farthest from anything and everything from that stage. It was like watching a play on my phone. It was so small, but I remember how it affected me. And it changed. I was sobbing by the end of the production. Sobbing. Oh, yeah. And then there's this one where you're thinking, I need to go clean and do laundry, but I don't want to be bored doing it. So you put this one on because I need to feel like my life has a little bit more action to it than what it is, because I'm changing the filter to my furnace and it's just not fun. So I get that song going. But the thing is we love music, and you've got this music that helps you kind of great triumph or sadness. There's something deep and even mysterious, I think, about it. And in both film and in television, music, it kind of guides our experience. And I think about if I'm watching a movie that's too scary, I do not like scary movies. I should say I don't like horror movies. I don't mind movies that have tension in it, but I don't like scary things. And so I'll have to close my ears, because it's amazing that when you close your ears off, when I limit sound, you realize how much music carries the emotion of the story. And so then you've got composers like John Williams, who did movies like Superman and Indiana Jones and Jurassic Park, and how much that affects the storyline. Or Randy Newman, who did all of the Pixar movies, or Hans Zimmer, who did the Batman movies. But they created these soundtracks that are memorable and amazing. And then in advertising, they do commercials that are designed. We've got to create a song fast that's going to engage someone who's viewing this. And so then you're like starting to rattle off McDonald's, like, I'm loving it. And then, but the thing is, these jingles, they start to grab you, and you never forget them. Hey. I needed that reminder. And this was one of my favorites as a kid. Learned it when I was six, and I still sing it. To eat it every day. And if you ask me why, I'll say, 'cause Oscar Mayer has a way with B-O-L-O-G-N-A. Oh, thank you guys for singing along with me on that one. But those songs, those jingles, they kind of weasel their way into your brain. And they kind of stick with you. And that one, you know, some of these, they stick with you your entire life. But I don't think that music is a mystery that just happens by chance. It's not an accident. It doesn't just randomly happen. It's not something even we can fully figure out. I think there's something actually spiritual about song. And as we experience music, because I think God is the source of all music, I think God is the composer of music. I think that is why it so deeply resonates inside of us. And as we experience music and song, I think we start to actually experience God himself. And through it, getting to know him a little bit better. And I think we learn more and more about God and God's heart and God's character when we hear song. And the biggest part, when we start to think about song happening in a church, is the idea of worship music is what most people think of when we want to incorporate music into a church. So every week we come in, and one of the aspects of worship, there are many different ways that we worship God, but one way is through music, through song. And so we've got songs and hymns that have actually been a part of the church and a worship for several thousand years. And if we didn't sing on a Sunday morning, if we came in and we just did announcements, maybe I said, hey, stand up and greet each other, and you're like, oh, that's awkward, I hate that part. Or you know, maybe we did a tithe line, or if we had the sermon and we went through the whole thing, but we never sang, you'd feel like, oh, I think we forgot something. I think we forgot something really important. And I know some people, they choose what church they're going to go to based on the music that is played. Well, I really want to go to the church that plays hymns. I don't like those contemporary churches that are all praise fluffy, God is happy, happy, happy all the time. I want the songs that bring me this deep theology. And then there's other ones that are like, man, I want to celebrate what God is doing in my heart. And I need to sing it. And those hymns, they just kind of, they don't take me there. And there's other people like, I want to be able to find a place that I can bring my own songs. Because God, you're still active and alive and you're moving today. And I want to be a part of a church where I can express what you're doing now. I want to theologize, not just tell theology. I want to actually share my theology, meaning understanding of God. I want to bring my theology, my understanding of God. And I'm wrestling with it and I want to be able to bring that. And so some people love that. And some people go, I just need it more upbeat. Others are like, I need it more deep and more meditative. And so we choose sometimes where we go to church based on the music. And I think that singing is worship, but not all worship is just singing and music. Singing is biblically the most frequent act of worship, but worship is so much more than that. It is a lifestyle. It's living aware of the presence of God in your heart, and that God is alive and in control of your life. It's being aware of His presence and living in tune with the Spirit of God, and then surrendering your life to God. But today we're only going to really just focus on music and song. I think the gift that God has given us is this wonderful, exciting adventure of song. I think there's three things that I really think that He's wanting us to experience out of that. And the first is that song really is praise. Song is praise. And that's usually what we really love here in this church, where it's kind of fun, it's upbeat, and it's kind of rocking, and it's kind of music that maybe you're cranking up in your car and you're listening to K-Love, and it's praising God for the blessings that He has given us and what He's done in our hearts and in our lives. And we're like, yeah, that is who my God is. And I want to proclaim that. And I want to be excited about that. And then I started to dig into the Bible. And the first place where a song is a song, does anyone know where the first time it's mentioned in the Bible? Pop quiz, you didn't study, did you? Ha! Well, it's Exodus 15. And it's right after God delivered the Israelites out of slavery in Egypt. And the Israelites had been in bondage, they had been in suffering for hundreds of years, and then God freed them, and as they're leaving, they're running away, they're kind of going away from the Egyptians, and then the Egyptians are like, wait, we just lost all our slaves, we want them back, what did we do? And so, send the army, and so the army's trump, coming after them, and so the Israelites are trying to get away, and they get stuck behind, there's a sea there, and they're stuck there, and they got the Israelite, or the Pharaoh and his army coming, and they're like, what do we do? And we don't want to be in bondage again. And so then God opens up the waves and they start walking through on dry land. They get to the other side and the Pharaoh and his armies are like, let's go after him. And they go, and then the waves, and they're all blub, 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 blub. And they're safe. The army's gone and they blubbed. And now they're like, woo, what do we do? And so Moses bursts forth with a song. He's like, and I'm not going to sing it for you because I don't know the tune, but I will sing to the Lord, for He is highly exalted. The Lord is my strength and my defense. He has become my salvation. He is my God, and I will praise Him. Who among the gods is like you, Lord? Who is like you? Majestic in holiness, awesome in glory, working wonders. In your unfailing love, you will lead the people you have redeemed. In your strength, you will guide them to your holy dwelling. The Lord reigns forever and ever. First song right there. And it came out of this experience of pain and suffering where they had been in bondage for over 400 years, and God sets them free, and He uses these miracles to do it. He rescues them from the oppression and domination and out of slavery. And they're delivered by them into this promised land, this journey that says, I'm going to take you to a land where you're going to know my presence. You're going to be intimate with me, and I'm going to be intimate with you. And when you're on the soil of this promised land, we're going to have a deep, intimate connection. You're going to know me. You're going to be my people. And they're like, yeah, I don't even not fully understand what this is, but I'm so excited. And thank you. And then we can see where God wrote, where people wrote other things throughout the scripture, like Romans, similar, is thank God. Once you were slaves to sin, but now you wholeheartedly obey this teaching we have given you. Now you are free from your slavery to sin. You have become slaves to righteous living. Colossians 1:11. May you be filled with joy. Yes, always thanking the Father. He has enabled you to share in the inheritance that belongs to the people who live in the light. For he has rescued us from the kingdom of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of his dear Son, who purchased our freedom and forgave our sins. He brought us. He did the same thing for us that he did for the Israelites. But the first song that is written in the scripture is a real song that was sung. And I love that. But there's also a metaphor in it, in that experience that ties us, many of us, if not all of us, to that same experience, which is once we were slaves to darkness and sin. And through the death and resurrection power of Jesus, we have been delivered from that. And now we are currently on this journey also toward the promised land that God has in store for all of us, the promised land where everything is going to be complete, where we have complete intimacy with God. And when we experience the saving grace of Jesus in our hearts, a natural reaction is a song comes out of us. One of the things I love about when we do baptisms in the church is that, you know, like we did one at Sandra's house this summer, and we baptized people in the Columbia River, and we kind of had this time of music and singing, and I remember just going, people's lives are being changed. And they have been changed, and they're expressing it, and they're sharing that with all of us. And I'm like, the power of God, you're doing something powerful among us. And my heart was just gripped by it, and my own heart started to celebrate because I was also remembering what it was that God did in me and how he changed me. And not just one time, but that it is still happening and that God is continuing to change me. And when I hear others share about how God has changed them, how they were in darkness and brought into the light, and God set them free from the bondage and the junk and the pain and the hurt that was inside of them and the addictions, my heart just like, yes, there is something powerful and mysterious here, and I need to praise God. And the very last song of the Bible that's recorded and written about is kind of the culmination of victory, where time has ended and this experience, people are experiencing that kind of the eternity with God. It's in Revelation 15. It says, they were singing the song of Moses, the servant of God, and the song of the Lamb. Great and marvelous are your works, O Lord God, the Almighty. Just and true are your ways, O kingdom of the nations. Who will not fear you, Lord, and glorify your name? For you alone are holy. All nations will come and worship before you, for your righteous deeds have been revealed. That is exactly what God is in the business of doing. He's in the business of saving and redeeming and reconciling, hurting people and healing them, bringing people into an intimate relationship one-on-one with them and corporately. And when that happens, there's something in us that responds with celebration and worship and praise. And many of you, you know exactly what I'm talking about. You've been there, or you're there even right now. Or maybe, you know, where you look back and you're thinking, oh, thank you, God. I know what you've done for me, even recently. And the celebration of what God has done for you, what that does is it draws us near to him, where we become more and more intimate, trusting God, leaning more into the presence of God. And there's this flow of praise that comes out of you when we start to thank God for who he is and what he's done for us, recognizing I could not have done this on my own. I needed you and everything you've given me and how you filled me and the blessings. And maybe some of us are singing maybe a different kind of song, though. There's other songs that we can sing. Maybe it's a song that's just honest and raw and real, something that is really deep inside of us. Because while praise songs are really great, there's also songs of pain, which is the second thing we are going to talk about here. Because church should be a place where we can sing those songs too. Where I don't always want to focus on God, because I'm going through some deep grief, and it's really hard to focus on God and maybe to be thankful or joyful when I'm like, but this is happening in my life, and I'm filled with sorrow or pain or loss. And when we're coming, you know, when we're coming out of that, it's hard to focus on the mountaintop. But the reality is that much of our lives is lived in the valleys, and there are shadows there, there is darkness there, there's hurts and pains and wounds, and it is the most Christian thing that we can do to be honest about them. Not to hide them, not to put on a silly happy face, but just go, yeah, today sucks. And it's hard. And it's not where I want to be. But I'm going to be honest and real. And God, I'm still going to lean into you. But I got to be able to share that. Most of us, maybe we don't associate song and worship with pain together. One of my absolute favorite psalms in the Bible is written by a guy named Asaph in Psalm 77. He says, my voice goes up to God and I'm going to cry out. My voice goes up to God and he will hear me. And I looked to the Lord when I was in trouble. I put out my hand at night and it did not get tired. My soul would not be comforted. When I remembered God, then I am troubled. When I am in deep thought, then my spirit becomes weak. You keep my eyes from closing, so I'm troubled that I cannot speak. I'm like, oh, there's something dark going on with you. And he keeps going. I have thought about the days of old, the years of long ago. I remember my song in the night. I think with my heart and my spirit ask questions. Will the Lord turn away forever? Will he never show favor again? Has his loving kindness stopped forever? Has his promise come from an end for all time? Has God forgotten to be loving and kind? Has he, in anger, taken away his loving pity? And then I said, it is my sorrow that the right hand of the Most High has changed. And when I read, I start to think, well, did the authors of the Bible miss this one? Like, where are the editors who were supposed to keep some of this painful questioning of God out? I mean, somehow it slipped through. I mean, here's a guy who's frustrated at God because he doesn't see that God actually loves him right now. And I'm like, maybe this is just a fluke. Maybe there's an accident that it got in the Bible. Maybe, except that when I then look at the book called Lamentations, it's kind of this poetic song by Jeremiah where all he does is lament and grieve about how people have broken the relationship with God through their sin. And I just want to give you one verse from the first chapter. Her oppression have become her masters, and her enemies prosper, for the Lord has punished Jerusalem for her many sins, and her children have been captured and taken away to distant lands. These are examples from God's Word, the Bible, of people writing songs about him and out of their pain. Years ago, I was dating a girl, and she's like, Kenny, a lot of your favorite songs are really depressing songs. She's like, you're fun, you're upbeat, and you're always telling jokes, but the music you listen to, it's really kind of sad. She's like, I don't get it. And I disagreed with her, and then I started to think about it. I'm like, no, I actually, oh, yeah, oh, yeah. And then I started to wonder, okay, why is it that I feel drawn and want to listen to these songs that are really sad, depressing songs? Maybe I've got some really deep-seated issues inside of me, which I did. But I let those questions linger, and I was thinking about them for a long time. So imagine being at a sporting event before the game starts, major sporting event, and so they play the national anthem, and everyone sits back down, and then the speaker, he goes to the microphone, and he makes an announcement to the entire crowd. He says, please stand up. If you have been affected in one way or another, suffered loss or grief, or personally, or you know someone with cancer. And everyone stands in some way, thousands of people rising to their feet. What would you feel? Compassion? Empathy? Solidarity? Connection? Love? An entire stadium full of people, and the word cancer is brought up, a very specific suffering, and instantly there's a bond between everyone there. And instead of mentioning the word cancer, what if they had come out and said, okay, everyone stand up who has been to Hawaii? Or stand up if you've ever been to Disneyland. Okay, stand up if you drive a minivan. It wouldn't really have the same effect. I mean, you still have many people stand up, but it wouldn't bring this connection. But suffering somehow unites us. And when we hear something that grows out of suffering and adversity, we're moved to be more honest and more real. And it means something because my heart starts to connect and my emotions are connecting and my bones to the other people around us, because every single one of us, we have experienced that hurt and that loss and that fear. Most people, I mean, they love movies and TVs. We love good stories, getting lost in a good book. I love a good song. I'm an Elton John fan. I love his music. I even get lost in a really good poem. Sometimes we step out of our own life and we imagine maybe being in a different world, or you kind of get lost going into a different world. But there's something deep inside of us that connects to what we know to be real. And when we hear a sad song or see a sad scene in a movie, or when we hear a song or a painful book, there's something inside of us that says, oh, I get that. Yeah, I've been there. Or I felt that pain, or I can understand that pain. I felt that loneliness before. I felt that abuse before. And there's something real about it. Psalm 77 and 88 in the book of, and also the book of Lamentations. There's other places in the Bible. What I gather is that God has given us the ability to sing and the ability to express pain to Him. And when the people were in a place of suffering or hurting or confusion, the reaction was to go and write to God about it. It wasn't to step out of their pain and go, well, I'll just wait until I'm better, or I'll just focus only on the good. What I love is that while in my pain, I can still sing it to God and I can share it honestly to God that this isn't how I like it to be or want it to be. And I'm wrestling through it, and I get, God, that you're probably going to lead me to a different perspective one day. But right now I'm not there, and I'm still going to be honest and real about where I am today. Most of the Psalms in the Bible are these Psalms of ascent, where the author is kind of on this upward trajectory towards worshiping God and understanding God. And many of them, they may kind of go, but they end, they always kind of come back up. No matter how painful the Psalm is, they always kind of come back and say, but God, you're still awesome and I understand you. But there's this one Psalm, Psalm 88. It is a brutal, expressing pain psalm of grief and loss. And it just goes down, 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 and it never comes back up. I'm like, oh. It just kind of leaves the pain hanging out there, not knowing what do I do with it. And I find it utterly beautiful. Because even in my deepest pain, I don't somehow have to come up with a big picture and acknowledge God. I can express pain and I can just leave it there. And maybe that's a place that some of you are even in today. You're not in a place of excitement or joy or deep awareness of soul satisfaction, but you're kind of leaning in this direction more of pain or fear. And sometimes it can feel debilitating or even crushing. Or maybe it's not that heavy, but it's still confusing, disconnecting from God, feeling uncertain. God has given a song to praise Him in that pain, and not to step outside it or to ignore it or to cover it up or to put on a happy face or pretend everything's okay. No, God says, praise and worship me even in the pain. And that is what church is for also, because God loves those songs too. God's desire is your authenticity more than what we look like. Songs like that are worship to Him. In fact, to sing to God even out of your pain, I don't know that there's a sweeter note that could come out. So instead of pretending to sing a song of praise and ignoring the pain, maybe he needs us to lean into it and sing a song of pain. And I just go, what an interesting thought that would be. Maybe you're at a college sporting event and they have the band, and they're always playing at great events like that, and they have these battle songs. I love those songs too. I love a good battle song, and because they kind of bond people, and you get a crowd cheering for their team, and when the band is playing at a sporting event, they want to fire people up so that maybe the players would play at their the highest possible level of performance, but it also unites the crowd so that we can be a part somehow of the competition. And that's what is interesting to me, is that song is designed to carry us into battle. Throughout the Bible, there are songs that are used as a weapon for battle. 2 Chronicles chapter 20. Early the next morning, the army of Judah went out into the wilderness of Tekoa, and on the way, Jehoshaphat stopped and said, "Listen to me, all you people of Judah and Jerusalem. Believe in the Lord your God, and you will be able to stand firm. Believe in the prophets, and you will succeed." After consulting the people, the king appointed singers to walk ahead of the army, singing to the Lord and praising him for his holy splendor. At the front of the army, he didn't put his strongest men, the greatest, most powerful swordsmen or spear throwers, or put the archers. He didn't bring his siege weapons. He's like, let's get a quartet going. I think these guys could do something really special. Let's get the baritones. Can we get them over here? Put the altos over there. We need a few sopranos. Hey, come on. We can do this. Have you guys been rehearsing? Because I think we've got something really special here. And bring your best songs. I mean, these people, well, how do we do, these singers are like, do I get a shield? Do I get a weapon? And you're like, no, you're going to use your voice. I just want you guys to sing. That had to have been so confusing for that band. This is what they sang. Give thanks to the Lord. His faithful love endures forever. At the very moment they began to sing and give praise, the Lord caused the armies of Ammon, Moab, and Mount Seir to start fighting among themselves. The armies of Moab and Ammon turned against the allies from Mount Seir and killed every one of them. After they had destroyed the army of Seir, they began attacking each other. So when the army of Judah arrived at the lookout point in the wilderness, all they saw were dead bodies laying on the ground as far as they could see. Not a single one of them, the enemy, had escaped. They haven't even gotten to the battlefield. They haven't even gotten there, and they're standing at the lookout point looking down at all the enemies, the whole army. They're like, what? What happened? This doesn't even make sense. All we had to do was sing. We just sang a song. We haven't even rehearsed. I mean, we were just warming up, and somehow God still did something great. Did you do your warm-up voices? I mean, I don't know. I'm still drinking my lemon tea. I wasn't even ready. I didn't even know that this was going to happen. And then the next story is even more out of control. Out of Joshua 6:2, the Lord said to Joshua, "I have given you Jericho, its king and all its strong warriors. You and your fighting men should march ahead of the town once a day for 6 days. 7 priests will walk ahead of you and of the ark, in each carrying a ram's horn. On the 7th day, you are to march around the town 7 times with the priests blowing the horns. When you hear the priests give one long blast of the ram's horn with all the people, shout as loud as you can. Use your vocals as loud as you can, and then the walls of the town will collapse and the people will charge straight into the town." Judges 7:19, Gideon and the 100 men with him reached the edge of the Midianite camp. Suddenly, they blew the ram's horn and broke the clay jars, and all three groups blew their horns, broke their jars. Inside, they had torches lit, and they held the blazing torches in their left hand and the horns in the right hands, and they all shouted, "A sword for the Lord and for Gideon!" And each man in his position around the camp and watched all the Midianites rush around in panic, shouting, and they ran to escape. And when the 300 Israelites blew the ram's horns, the Lord caused the warriors in the camp to fight against each other with their swords. God's people never did anything. These guys are not strong warriors. They're not bringing their weapons. All they're doing is bringing their trumpets and their horns and their voices and their shouting. And somehow, through all of that, God does battle on our behalf. Suddenly, something I found really helpful for me about 10 years ago was I was going through a really really, really dark season about 14 years ago. Really painful. Life just hit me. I had made some bad choices, kind of a combination of everything. Every time I got in my car, I was doing construction work. Every time I got in the car, I just turned on the Christian radio. It's like I can't listen to any music other than Christian music because there was something powerful in it, and I felt like God was using it to fight for my heart. 30 years ago, I came to Christ because of Keith Green music, and I believe that I am a follower of Jesus and even a pastor now because of Keith Green.
Make my life a prayer to you. I want to do what you want me to. No empty words, no white lies, no token prayers, no compromise.
I can't say that you're all going to run out and buy Keith Green music. But for whatever reason, the lyrics and the words grip my heart. And I heard it, and I'm like, I can't stop listening to this guy. He challenged me to not compromise my life and to be better, to be God's best version of me. And that's all I listened to 30 years ago for about a year was Keith Green, just about, maybe a few other Christian artists. And I listen to secular music now, but I also go, I also need a steady stream of Christian music because I know it does something inside of me. There is divine power in music, that through it, God does divine battle in ways that I cannot, and that through music and songs, it glorifies Him. And I think God does battle in the spiritual arena and sometimes in the physical ways that we can't even always comprehend or understand. Song is worship. Song as battle that is designed to glorify and worship Him. And back in the 90s, I had a worship album that I would just put on repeat when I was in probably 1995, and I would just listen to this other artist, and I couldn't get enough of it. And I've played it in this church several times, and I would just cry it out, God, light the fire again. And that was my prayer. God, I just need You. I need You, I need You. I don't know if any of you have ever tried to use music and song as battle for your own soul. Music as your fight song. Most of us, we think of the Bible and the songs in it. We think maybe of the book of Psalms where they're laid out, where you've got these 150 different songs that have been sung to God. But what did they mean to the people that wrote them? What do they mean to the people who sang them? The word psalms means praise, to sing praise, to make music, to play with a musical instrument. It's designed to give the imagery of someone striking, like I'm doing a guitar, my little air guitar. But it's designed to be more like, you guys all do it at some point. You're like, I'm just... But it's meant to be striking of the strings. So back then, it was probably maybe more like a little harp. You had like four strings. I don't know how many strings they had. But that is the imagery that's meant to come with the word psalms. It's designed to be, there's a physical element and a physical action to the experience. The idea of worshiping song is not something that was observed or that you're kind of in the middle of. It was something that you participate, that you created. It was an activity, and it was never a passive one. Our culture, we're very much more comfortable if we can get the best musicians, let them come, and we'll let them lead us. They've got a certain caliber or quality or confidence that maybe many of us don't. We would feel really stupid if we just started going up on stage trying to lead other people on. You're like, I can't do it. I don't really have the skills, or I don't have the voice. And we're looking for, oftentimes, some of us, churches where we want the best music. In fact, that's why I go to the church. If they don't have the best, I don't want to go there. And so we start to get critical. Well, is it the right kind of music? I mean, is it the music that really is going to feed my soul? Is it going to, you know, we start to critique, well, today I wasn't as good. Last week was great because it somehow helped me connect to God. But today I didn't connect to God. I wasn't excited, or they didn't match my mood. And so they didn't do a good job. And we can be very critical. But according to Scripture, it has more to do with the physical act of it is that we participate. One of the first acts of worship, a reference to worship, has nothing to do with singing in the Bible. Genesis chapter 22 says, "Stay here with the donkey." Abraham told his servants, "The boy and I are going to travel a little further up. We will worship there, and then we will come right back." So maybe they are going to go sing a song with their guitar and egg shaker. The word worship here means to bow down, though. To bow down, to prostrate yourself before God. We're going to go up and we're going to go bow down and prostrate ourselves and fall before God. And it's not a reference to singing or music, because at the root, worship is an action. Even song is an action. And when we hear amazing, talented musician or really talented vocalist or even see the beauty of dance, there's something that we respond to, that we're experiencing, where we start to go at it and feel it at maybe a deeper level. You might think, well, I can't sing. I don't have any rhythm. I'm actually tone deaf. I don't know how to play an instrument. It makes no sense to me how they do what they do. But the thing is, it's not about how we sound. It never has been. In fact, it's not about us. God isn't remotely concerned with our level of talent or our level of ability or how it comes out sounding at all. Some of the most heartfelt worshipers are completely tone deaf because it has nothing to do with their voice. The central core of what song in Scripture means is to tremble or to stand up. I love that. Has nothing to do with talent or ability. It has everything to do with our heart and how we respond in reverence to God. It's not what you play. It's about how great our God is, and we stand amazed. And out of that springs this physical engagement, whether I'm going to bow down and I'm going to worship you, or I stand up and I'm going to raise my hands because I don't know how else, but I need to engage. I need to engage. Somehow I need to connect, and I need my body to be put in a position that, for whatever reason, when I get in that position, feels like I'm submitting to how great you are, and I'm recognizing that you are God and that I am not God. When was the last time you did something like that, or you made a song for God? Where maybe you raised your hands in worship, and sometimes you're like, I can't do it. Everyone's watching me. Close your eyes. Pretend there's no one there. Sometimes that's why I sit in the front, is because I just, if I'm anywhere else, I feel like I can't block people out. What if you just dance before God? And I'm not saying we're going to be crazy dancers. I don't know what kind of church we're going to be. We're going to be a church that responds to God kind of church. I don't know how we do that. But what if we're like, God, I just need to lean more into you. What if I just push these chairs? Do you know why? That's why we have no pews here. Was because we wanted chairs that we could shove. So shove a chair and say, I'm going to make room so I can fall on the ground if I need to just put myself in a position where I'm on my knees before you, God. Or if you're like, well, I can't do that. Well, then go to the back. I don't care what you do. Or you stand. And sometimes we're, you know, Kent will say, hey, stand with me. Because it's awkward that I'm standing alone. How about you stand with me? Let's all do it. But more than that, it's like, if you were in the Mediterranean and you grew up as a follower of Jesus in the Mediterranean 2,000 years ago, that is how you praise God. I lift my head and my eyes. We're like, well, we got to bow our head when we pray. No, you don't bow your head. You lift it and you look to the heavens because, God, you're up there, and I open my hands because I want to worship you, God. Reverence is not bowing, but maybe it is. Maybe you bow. You're like, no, because I'm more out of the medieval times where we had an actual physical king who would kill us, and if you didn't bow and submit yourself and you bow your head so your head could get cut off and he has the power to control your life and death, well, then maybe that's reverence. I don't care how, which you know, culture you take your idea of what respect and honor and reverence is, but grab one of them and run with it and say, I'm going to do something. I'm going to move forward because, God, you've done something in my heart and in my life. Have you ever written a song or a psalm? A psalm that goes up, God, you're so awesome. Or maybe you write a song, God, I'm just so hurting and I'm so confused. You write a psalm of ascent or descent, or you sing a praise, or maybe a song of battle. If we could have your team come on back up. I just want to close by reading Psalm 150. Praise the Lord. Praise God in His sanctuary. Praise Him in His mighty heaven. Praise Him for His mighty works. Praise His unequaled greatness. But then it becomes active. Praise Him with a blast of the ram's horn. Praise Him with the lyre and the harp. Praise Him with the tambourine and dancing. Praise Him with the strings and the flutes. Praise Him with the clash of cymbals. Praise Him with loud clanging cymbals. Let everything that breathes sing praises to the Lord. Praise the Lord.
God, I'm on my knees again. God, I'm begging, please again. I need you. Oh, I need you. Walking down these desert roads, water for my thirsty soul. I need you. Oh, I need you. Your forgiveness is like sweet, sweet honey on my lips. It's like the sound of a symphony to my ears. It's like holy water on my skin.
Like home.